Okay, a very, very warm good afternoon to all our participants who have joined across India, Nepal, Maldives, and Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. All those who have joined in nationally and internationally, welcome you all to this first series of webinar that is being conducted by Reshe Healthcare and Shulke India Private Limited. So we would like you to welcome you to the series on infection prevention and control, especially focusing on the COVID-19 pandemic that is there. So we would again welcome all of you here. So as we know, these are challenging times that we are facing with the COVID-19 pandemic. It is rampantly spreading across all spheres, and it has taken our healthcare system by a surprise. And a lot of our doctors, nurses, and administrators have been taken back by how do we prepare, how do we handle this. So it is very important that we as healthcare workers are adaptable and adopting to new techniques and new ideas that are there so that we can handle this pandemic in a better way. So to keep this and to bring more such series of webinars, this is the first of the series. We will have three more webinar series coming up in the next coming months. Please keep in tune with us. We will keep you informed on those. Reshe Healthcare is a consulting firm based out of Hyderabad and Dubai, and we bring such unique programs to you. Shulke India is a 130-year-old company that has been in the infection prevention space and has been bringing out some very innovative solutions when it comes to preventing infections across the hospitals and our homes that are there. So with that, we would like you to welcome you to this webinar. So without further delay, as we are talking about, I would like to welcome our speaker for today, our esteemed speaker for today, Dr. Aruna Pujari, who is the head of Department of Pathology and Microbiology at the esteemed hospital of Breach Candy Hospital Trust in Mumbai in India. And she has conducted a number of CMEs across India. She has delivered over 100 lectures that have been there. I have been a part of many of them, and I know she's a wonderful speaker to us. She has had over 23 international and national peer-reviewed publications. She's also published a chapter in the API textbook of medicine on non-tuberculosis mycobacteria. She's also a teaching student for DNB. She's a lecturer for CPS, DVF, FCPS, medicine and tropical diseases, PG teacher for MSc microbiology also is there. And she has keen interest when it comes to infection control, mycobacterium, and quality management systems in lab and teaching. And she's the team lead for the infection control team leading the COVID battle at Breach Candy Hospital. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Madam. Please welcome to this session. And I would like to hand over my session to Dr. Aruna Pujari. Ma'am, you can please take over from here onwards.
Thank you, Dr. Shashank, for those kind words. And I'd like to, at the outset, thank Reshe Healthcare as well as Shulke for giving me an opportunity to be here and sharing this very important topic of hospital preparedness for the COVID-19 pandemic. Some of our experiences is what I'm going to share, and naturally available information coming out of literature, which will be very useful to us on how we prepare our hospitals. So let me start off with the topic for today, and good evening, everyone. So we know that this SARS-CoV-2 belongs to the family of coronaviridae, which is actually an RNA virus. And most of the coronaviridae family actually cause infections in humans as a zoonotic disease. Now, SARS-CoV-2 is found to have 86% similarity with SARS-CoV-1. And the infection started in Wuhan, China, in December 2019. WHO declared it as a pandemic on 11th March 2020. WHO also called the disease caused by SARS-CoV-2 as COVID-19. So the word COVID-19 actually comes in from there. So the disease is called COVID-19, and the infection, the virus, is naturally SARS-CoV-2. So as of today, we have about 32 million cases and 1 million deaths. That's a huge number, and we're still not out of the woods, is what I think. And therefore, this very important topic of how to prepare ourselves for the coming days. Some of us might be in the surge phase, and some of us might have moved into the post-surge phase. So, very important in understanding prevention strategies and implementing prevention strategies would be to know how transmission can be stopped. And that certainly we all know that respiratory droplets, aerosolization, and inanimate objects and fomites play a very important role in the transmission of SARS-CoV-2. And fecal-oral route also has a potential role, though it is not yet proven, because the virus could not be cultured from stool samples as yet. As has been mentioned by Dr. Shashank, the healthcare sector has actually faced a lot of challenges during this COVID-19 pandemic. We've almost been caught unaware, and we've been just pushed into managing the pandemic. And each of us, I'm sure, have had some kind of preparedness plan for the surge phase. So large number of patients coming in for COVID medical management at that time. We were in this phase here in Mumbai somewhere around April, May, and June. And so we had a large number of patients then. We faced a lot of challenges in terms of manpower shortages because of staff reassignment so that we could manage our COVID patients better, which were in maximum numbers. A lot of them went into isolation, went into quarantine. A lot of them had a lot of fear and to attend hospital. And so overall, there was so much of absenteeism which we had to deal with. There were infrastructure shortages with negative pressure rooms not being present, ICU bed scarcity, ventilators, oxygen supply scarcity, and all of us know about the scarcity of personal protective equipment. And at that point in time, in fact, the government of India had a circular which said that stop all non-essential services, but certainly ensure all emergency medical as well as surgical services to be continued as such. And here in India, at least, we've got divided in terms of hospitals into those hospitals which are only COVID hospitals. There are some hospitals which are only non-COVID hospitals. And there are certain hospitals like ours which are mixed hospitals. So we have a COVID wing as well as a non-COVID wing. And each of the such kind of hospitals would have to have their own preparedness plan and how their patient flow is going to be managed. Now, in the post-surge phase, what happens? So we have to some extent moved into the post-surge phase. Now, in the post-surge phase, you start off with your routine activities, at least slowly. And there you want to triage your medical and surgical patients correctly. You want to open up outpatient services. And there's a whole lot of diagnostics that is now available than what was available in the month of March and April. And with the help of these diagnostics, we want to ensure that we manage our non-COVID cases also correctly. And probably as we move on into the post-surge phase, and as hopefully in the coming months, the pandemic would be controlled, hospitals would move from non-COVID becoming non-COVID, and probably mixed hospitals would also be there. But there'll be little scope for only COVID hospitals, because the number of cases would be less. So when a hospital has to have a preparedness program for managing a pandemic, this is what CDC has to say. So this preparedness program must prevent the spread of respiratory viruses, including SARS-CoV-2, within the facility. It should be able to monitor and manage staff affected by COVID-19. It should ensure the safety of COVID and non-COVID patients who are admitted into the hospital. And there should be effective communication within the hospital as well as externally, because all of us have to report to the state and national authorities, and that communication should be correct. So I want to highlight upon this part of it, that we don't only prepare for SARS-CoV-2, but we really prepare ourselves for respiratory viruses. Because as we are seeing in the last 2 weeks here, at least in Mumbai, that apart from SARS-CoV-2, we've started seeing seasonal influenza coming in. We've started, in fact, today I saw one coronavirus NH strain coming up. And so other respiratory viruses are also being seen, and we should actually have a preparation to handle those cases as well. Now, with a preparedness program in place, we need to implement it within the hospital. And this implementation will naturally comprise of a multidisciplinary team that is looking at the various aspects of how the program can be delivered and implemented within the hospital. It would certainly require dedicated space. That is, you would need to have space allocation for your COVID as well as non-COVID patients and different categories of patients. There will need to be standard operating procedures which are well documented and clearly written, understanding and taking into consideration the practical aspects of problems that we might be actually facing on the ground, documenting any challenges that are observed, training people who are involved in giving care. And this does not only include your doctors and nurses, but would also include a lot of support staff and staff from various departments who are ultimately supporting clinical care. Then performing mock drills. This is something which is very, very important because as we've all understood that after wearing PPE, it's not very easy to communicate. So performing mock drills and ensuring that instructions are understood correctly and followed makes a lot of difference. Monitoring your procedures, performing audits to ensure that compliance is there, and looking at literature. And with whatever available new information, making policy reviews would be an important part of implementing any preparedness program. And this preparedness program naturally is a delicate balance between patient as well as staff safety. And when patient and staff safety comes into our mind, I would like to here mention that it is this has always been central to infection prevention and control. We have our standard precautions, which have always been part of our hospital infection control program, which comprises of hand hygiene, use of appropriate PPEs, respiratory hygiene, safe injection practices, sharp safety, spill management, environmental disinfection, and all of these are a part of our standard precautions, which is integral to any hospital infection control program. And if you see, when it comes to IPC preparation from the point of view of the COVID pandemic, there would be further enhancement on these. So we should not forget standard precautions, and further strengthen standard precautions is what I would like to emphasize here, because it will help us in ensuring patient as well as staff safety. Now, when we talk about the COVID-19 pandemic, there is enough published in literature now and well known that there are nosocomial infections of SARS-CoV-2, just like any other nosocomial infections that we want to prevent. And from that point of view, if we want to prevent such infections, whether it's clusters amongst healthcare workers working within the hospital, or it is clusters amongst patients who get admitted, we need to ensure that we are working well, having a proper flow and documentation of how we work around patients in the outpatient. How do you triage patients who are coming into your hospital, walk in, maybe you have a fever OPD or things like that. How does your flow go on with your inpatients when they are positive, whether they're suspected, whether they're negative? Having dedicated space, which is basically your isolation rooms, with respect to monitoring beds, with respect to ward, with respect to labor rooms, or even your OR complex. Having a proper documented recovery plan, it could be for your medical patients as well as surgical patients, and various measures to ensure that that surface contamination is actually prevented. So let's look at what happens to outpatient clinics. So naturally, during the surge phase, we were all asked that our outpatient clinic should be shut, and we should actually be dedicating all our resources and towards managing COVID patients. But now that some of us are in the post-surge phase, we have initiated OPDs, and that's of course according to what provisions and resources are available to us within our healthcare setting. So most of us would have already started with virtual OPDs, especially if you're in a setting like mine where we don't have enough, our hospital is not very big and therefore don't have enough space. With those challenges in hand, we have continued with our virtual OPDs, where screening questions for corona is asked for patients. If the patient really needs to get examined, then this is done strictly on an appointment based with enough time duration left between two patients, and ensuring that social distancing is maintained in the OPD areas. Another very important aspect of these virtual OPDs, or maybe OPDs on site, would be re-stratifying your patients based upon their symptoms, based upon the kind of clinical care that they need, and based upon any invasive procedures that need to be done, which will pose a risk to your healthcare worker. So accordingly, they need to be categorized just in case they need to get admitted. Now, triaging is a very common word that we have been using during the pandemic. And as per CDC, the definition is basically sorting out and classifying patients or casualties to determine priority of need and proper placement and treatment. So the person who requires urgent treatment should be seen first is what it actually means. And in this situation, when it comes to the COVID-19 pandemic, we basically want to separate out the infected from the non-infected. And also we want to allow our healthcare workers to adopt optimum practices to prevent acquiring any infection. That's what is the essence of triaging patients when it comes to the COVID-19 pandemic. This is what we want. And how are we going to achieve triaging? Maybe you have a fever OPD or a fever clinic or a triage OPD like we have, where you have patients who come in. They could be emergency, they could be walk-in, they are screened for symptoms of corona, very quick questionnaire for symptoms and questions like whether you have had any contact previously, whether you've been tested, whether you've been positive in the past. So early in the month of April and May, we had very few patients who were actually COVID positive. So we didn't ask them whether you had a past history of COVID-19 illness. But now, 6 months into the pandemic, we have added this question of whether you have a past history of COVID-19 illness or not, or even whether any of your family members have got affected, whether you reside in a containment zone. So again, these questions need to be tweaked according to your geographical location and your epidemiological situation at that point in time with respect to the pandemic. And once you identify that, yes, this patient has some features which could point towards COVID, the patient may be diverted to a fever clinic or a triage OPD where they would be taken care of. They would be investigated, they'd be swabs would be taken, and accordingly decided whether the management is going to be inpatient or outpatient depending upon availability of quarantine facilities for those patients. And naturally, in such areas, you would want to have a visitor policy. So most of us have restricted visitor policy. We have not allowed visitors to come into the hospitals as yet. Dedicated staff so that they are in small teams. It helps us manage the situation better. Availability of appropriate personal protective equipment, hand rubs, maintaining distance, posters, and very clear signages for patients of how they are going to move about. Otherwise, they land up roaming around within the hospital premises, which can further be a risk to all the others. Now, let's look at a case. I'm going to share with you some of the cases that we have ourselves encountered and hoping that some of you would also put in your reactions there. So this is a 60-year-old male who came with headache and dizziness. And since he had headache, our screening counter actually diverted him to the triage OPD, where we look after patients who may have some one or the other symptoms of COVID. But in the triage OPD, we found that he did not have any history of COVID in the past. There was no family member who was affected. He was never quarantined. On examination, he didn't have any fever. His saturation was normal, but his blood pressure was 200/100. And he did have a headache. And he was a patient who could not be, being asked to go home, and he needed admission. So now think about where he needs to get admitted. So if this patient has at least one symptom, though it's not a dominant symptom, but some people have variations in their levels of tolerance. So with this headache, naturally one would not put this patient into a non-COVID area. And we admitted this patient into the COVID area. We took his swabs, etc., and moved on further. His swab came negative, in the further next couple of days, he was managed for his blood pressure and then was discharged. Now, in other cases, this is a 30-year-old pregnant woman who requires admission for delivery at 37 weeks. Now, she was found COVID positive 14 days ago and had mild symptoms at that point in time. Now she has no symptoms. Okay. But a recent PCR done 3 days back was positive. Now, where do you think should she get admitted? She's coming for her routine delivery. She was positive 14 days back. Now, this is a situation which we did not find in the months of April and May, but we've recently started encountering more and more of such cases. Now, what does CDC have to say? CDC says that those patients who are asymptomatic or have mild symptoms, if their isolation precautions can be discontinued on day 10 or 11 if they do not have any symptoms in the last 48 hours. So this patient is already 14 days post her positive PCR. She has no symptoms now, and for the last 48 hours, she's not had any symptoms. So this patient, if she wants to get admitted now, would ideally qualify to get admitted into a non-COVID area. She need not get admitted into a COVID area because she qualifies into the symptoms of discontinuation of isolation precautions. Now, what about this recent PCR report, which is a positive 3 days back? So this is something that one must understand and how have an understanding of how our diagnostics are working. We know that PCR does not indicate viability of the virus. So basically what we pick up is the RNA of the of SARS-CoV-2, and it could be live, alive or dead. And most viral culture indicates that the organism is non-viable by day 10, day 11. So that's one reason why CDC has said that isolation precautions may be discontinued in mild cases if the patient has been asymptomatic for the last 2 days and post 10 days it could be discontinued. So we could actually admit this patient in a non-COVID area. Now, what about surgical care? Surgical care is a little different. Naturally, one needs to identify whether it's emergency, elective or semi-urgent. And a lot depends upon personnel because they are dedicated, they are experts. Whether there is space available, again, you would need to identify your COVID and non-COVID ORs, expendables that are required and the devices which are present. So all of this is going would be needed to identify whether you would take a patient on a list or not. And there are a lot of acuity scales that have been published. This comes from the fellow of American College of Surgeons, where they have classified patients based upon their acuity status, and accordingly they would take up this patient for surgery as an emergency surgery or postpone the surgery. Similarly, this comes this is a scale that comes in from the University Irving, Columbia University Irving Medical Center, where they have looked at their space and personnel, devices, expendables, and post-operative resources required by patients for their surgery and put them into an intensity score of low, medium, and high. Low, medium, and high, and accordingly identified whom they are going to take up for surgery based upon low resource intensity, medium resource intensity, and high resource intensity. So a lot of acuity scales and intensity score scales are available, which can be adopted based upon your own healthcare setup, so that you can take up patients. And this is particularly important in the post-surge phase, where we have started taking up routine surgical cases. So acuity scales would help us identify patients who need to be taken up for surgery earlier. Now, another case again here, she is a 38-year-old pregnant woman who requires admission for an emergency LSCS. Her COVID PCR was done 2 weeks back. Where do we admit her? So according to our protocol that we have devised in the hospital, we would naturally, this COVID PCR 2 weeks back is a little too late, and besides that, in Mumbai, we being a red zone, we see a lot of infections, and a lot of patients remain asymptomatic. So therefore, we would naturally take this patient into the COVID area, and we would naturally perform the emergency LSCS in our COVID OR, which is equipped to do take up such kind of procedures. And would we wait for a PCR result? All organizations are very, very clear that we do not wait for any kind of PCR result or test results to come in if this is an emergency procedure. Of course, if you have the availability of POC devices like GeneXpert, BioFire, Abbott Now, then all of these are rapid PCRs. If you have those available with you, and you are approved and authorized to perform such PCRs, which can give you results within 1 or 2 hours, you may naturally go ahead and perform the PCR and then decide to take this patient up for surgery in the non-COVID OR if the COVID is negative. Now, coming to inpatients. Now, inpatient segregation is something which is very, very important over here, and this is an important part of the triaging process. So you need to identify your patients as suspect, positive or negative. And this has to be done across all the clinical specialties, whether it is medical, surgical, pediatrics, obstetrics and gynae, and so on and so forth. And once you have identified suspect and COVID areas, naturally one would want, if you are a mixed hospital, you would want separate entry, separate exit, separate lifts and route for access to the COVID and the non-COVID areas. Similarly, operating rooms, ICUs, labor rooms would need to be segregated. For isolation rooms, you could have single rooms. It is preferable that suspects are put in single rooms. You may also have cohort areas, and in these cohort areas, the bed should be at least at 3 feet distance. And naturally, equipments need to be dedicated. All such isolation areas should have donning and doffing rooms, and preferably with bathrooms, because that's something very important from the point of view of healthcare worker safety. And the doffing room is supposed to be one of the most contaminated areas. So having a bath post doffing certainly helps in reducing contamination and preventing infections in healthcare workers. So here's another case. This is a 39-year-old male who presented with fever and cough, was diagnosed as lobar pneumonia. We admitted him to the suspect ward, but his two PCRs have been negative on day one and day three. Should we transfer him to a non-COVID area? Now, this is something, again, that we have been seeing frequently. We all know that the PCR is, the real-time PCR is not really something that has very good or adequate sensitivity as we would want. Its sensitivity somewhere around 70%. There are lots of variables that would decide whether your PCR would come positive or negative. And one of the very important aspects is going to be the collection of the specimen. So whether only a nasal specimen is collected, whether nasal or oropharyngeal is collected, whether it's put into the same viral transport medium, and how quickly is it transported to the testing laboratory, whether the cold chain is maintained. So there are lots of variables which might result into a COVID, a false negative PCR. And therefore, in such a case, one should be very, very wary and maybe hold the patient in this particular area, treat the patient, and maybe repeat a swab would be a good strategy. And later on, with the availability of antibodies, which are seen to get, which are seen to become positive somewhere in the second or third week, one could naturally do antibodies and prove that this was or not COVID pneumonia. Another thing that needs to be done simultaneously would be, apart from, you know, trying to find out whether this is really COVID, one would also need to perform investigations to rule out other routine known causes of lobar pneumonia. For example, the bacterial causes like Streptococcus pneumonia or Haemophilus influenzae. So hold him in this area. This area. Don't be in a hurry to really transfer this patient out of this area, and perform repeat tests. Another case here, a 70-year-old female admitted in the COVID ICU with fever, breathlessness, and she was PCR positive naturally, ventilated because she worsened, and was treated over a period of 4 weeks with remdesivir, steroids, even tocilizumab was given, and with supportive therapy. On day 32, she's clinically better off supportive ventilation and now needs to be transferred. So where would we transfer? Again, this is a situation that we are increasingly seeing a lot of patients who enter into the ICU. Now, remain there for around 3 to 4 weeks, and then subsequent to that they need to be taken, still taken care of in the intensive care setting, but do they need to remain really in the COVID ICU, or can they be transferred? So if this patient needs, can this patient be transferred? Yes, according to CDC, isolation precautions can be stopped in patients who are immunosuppressed or immunocompromised, or who are critically ill at day 20 if in the last 48 hours they are doing well and clinically stable. So she qualifies for that this particular provision, and therefore, because she is clinically better, we may shift her, depending upon her requirement, into a non-COVID area, whether it is ICU or ward. So this is something, again, that needs to be taken into consideration, because we know that our need for COVID ICU has increased, and those patients who remain in there for a long time need to therefore be managed elsewhere, especially if they are more than 21 days old in that area and still require intensive care. Now, when it comes to ensuring safety of healthcare workers, I've already mentioned it's standard precautions. That's very, very important. But a few additional requirements and provisions that need to be made in taking into consideration from the pandemic preparedness point of view would be how hand hygiene is a little different than how we would do hand hygiene as a routine. Use of personal protective equipments from the point of view of droplet infection and contact. Staffing issues need to be taken into consideration. A lot of preparation and communication between teams is required. And how are we going to reduce exposure in general to our healthcare workers? So while performing aerosol generating procedures, while ensuring that ventilation is taken care of, sharp safety, biomedical waste management, as well as environmental decontamination. So hand hygiene remains the same, the five moments, the areas which we miss routinely. So hand washing is an absolute essential part of how you take care of the COVID pandemic, whether it's the COVID area or the non-COVID area. But there are a few additions when it comes to managing COVID patients. So when you are donning and doffing, CDC says perform hand hygiene using alcohol rubs after every step of donning as well as doffing. Secondly, it's something very, very important that we need to be conscious about, that you, hand hygiene in the COVID areas is done with gloves on. Think that it is your hands that you are doing hand hygiene. So this is something that I have in practical experience found that people forget when they, healthcare workers, when they wear gloves, they forget to do hand hygiene. Please, when you're working in the COVID areas, remember to do hand hygiene as frequently, taking all the five moments of hand hygiene into consideration, and keep doing hand hygiene with alcohol rubs over your gloves. Then hand hygiene before touching your face, as much as is possible, keep reminding this to yourself. And moment five becomes extremely important. Most of these patients, particularly when they land up in the ICU, would be bombarded with a lot of immunosuppressive agents. And it is at this point in time that moment five becomes very, very important and becomes very crucial, because all the opportunistic pathogens that are there in the environment can cause secondary bacterial infections, or even invasive fungal infections are seen in patients, particularly in the ICU. And therefore, moment five of hand hygiene becomes very, very important while managing COVID-19 patients. Similarly, when it comes to PPE availability, we want PPE to be readily available, because that's one of the most crucial steps or requirements of ensuring that we manage the pandemic well. Risk stratification is important, because we know PPE is a scarce resource. Of course, it is more readily available now than it was during the months of March, April, May, June. So use of personal protective equipment is something very, very crucial and central to how we manage the COVID-19 pandemic and prepare for it within the hospital. So ready availability is very important. Risk stratification based upon the type of activity is very important, because it allows us to allocate our resources and PPE available correctly. Ensuring separate donning and doffing rooms, having a buddy system to help don and doff helps in reducing breaches while donning and doffing. And again, as I said previously, doffing is one of the most contaminated activities, and therefore ensuring that healthcare professionals doff correctly is very, very important. Healthcare personnel should be instructed that they should use PPE only in isolation areas. They should never leave isolation areas while wearing PPE. And training on PPE use is extremely important. And this is not only once again to nurses and doctors, but all the support staff who will visit that area. So whether it is your phlebotomist, whether it is your ward boys and other support staff, it's important that all of them receive appropriate training for use of PPE, both donning as well as doffing. And this is the guidelines on the rational use of personal protective equipment coming from the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, India, where clearly we need to identify tasks into high risk, moderate risk, and low risk, and accordingly utilize various different types of PPE that is available. Now, another aspect when it comes to preventing healthcare worker transmission would be staffing. We understand that staffing should be, we can't overcrowd our department. So having small teams prevents crowding and allows us to have backup teams. Now, if one team gets affected, you would have a backup team to take over, which will not compromise your clinical care. And we ensure that there is the list of personnel who attend on a daily basis is maintained so that contact tracing becomes easy, because contact tracing ultimately is a very, very important part of ensuring prevention of horizontal transfer when it comes to COVID-19. So then comes another important aspect from the point of view of hospital preparedness would be ensuring proper ventilation standards in the isolation room. Now, this is India has a document from Engineering Society, which says that relative humidity of these isolation rooms should be 40% to 70%. Area should be well ventilated, avoid split ACs. If possible, have a dedicated heating, ventilation and air changes exchange system. Of course, this may be difficult, but then if you can make provisions, have a dedicated HVAC system. Negative pressure rooms with minimum 2.5 Pascal pressure is what is recommended by this guidance. And one can use exhaust fans in their inpatient rooms to achieve this particular pressure. Fresh air is very important, ensuring that at least one third of fresh air changes is injected into the room is very, very important, with at least 12 air changes per hour in these isolation rooms. Treatment of exhaust air should preferably done by HEPA filtration. Now, this might become a little difficult, especially when you are in the surge phase and you are not prepared. So if you have time to prepare, this can be done, because this would naturally require engineering to come into effect. Now, very important, and this is especially for the ICUs, is ensuring that the grills are cleaned regularly. So otherwise, if the maintenance of these HVAC systems is not done correctly, patients in the intensive care are likely to have secondary bacterial and fungal infections. So a lot of secondary infections would be seen, and especially because these are immunocompromised individuals. So the engineering team has to provide clinical teams with a lot of support, ensuring that ventilations are done correctly. Similarly, what about ventilation in the OR? Negative pressure is what is ideal, but again, making your operating room negative pressured is not going to be something which is very, very easy, especially if you are you're already in the middle of the pandemic. So it may not be feasible at all places. And in such situations, one can dedicate an operating room or an operating room complex. Preferably, it should have laminar airflow, and it should have a dedicated air handling unit. And the air changes per hour should be anything more than 25 air changes per hour. During induction, minimal staff should be present, should be remaining closed at all times. And overall, when performing such surgeries, the number of staff should be minimal. And a list of all the staff who have attended individual surgeries is something which is important to be maintained. Once again, in order to perform contact tracing if it is required. Now, as healthcare professionals, we should be very, very clear about what are the aerosol generating procedures that may happen or occur within the hospital setting, because this is something which is the most important and the riskiest of the procedures while caring for COVID-19 patients. And in fact, I would say that, you know, this procedure, the precautions that are taken while performing aerosol generating procedures should be the same both in COVID as well as non-COVID areas. So when it comes to the laboratory, it would be swab collection, sputum collection, centrifugation, vortexing, sonication, handling stool specimens. When it comes to the clinical areas, it could be bronchoscopy, nebulization, chest physiotherapy, BiPAP and CPAP, open suctioning, cardiac massage, high flow oxygens. In the OR, any kind of tracheal surgeries, head and neck surgeries, colonoscopy, all of these are very high risk aerosol generating procedures, and therefore one must ensure maximum protection is taken when this is undertaken. Next, to protect both patients as well as healthcare workers, we need to look about take care of environmental decontamination, and this should preferably a systematic and coordinated planned approach. A checklist would help in minimizing errors and omissions. This is something which is very, very important, because we know that inanimate objects, fomites and surfaces play a very important role when it comes to transmission of COVID-19. All personnel who are performing this activity need to wear personal protective equipment, ensure thorough cleaning and disinfection between the cases at the end of the day, at the end of the week in case of the OR, and otherwise in the ICU it should be as frequent. Sometimes, you know, meaning while we all did at least once in every shift, depending upon how your situation is and how heavy your workload is, you may need to increase frequency. We have started doing every 2-hourly cleaning and disinfection in our ICU. So you can devise your own policy on how frequently you want to do cleaning and disinfection. Soap and water cleaning is something which is very, very important and an integral part of how cleaning and disinfection is done. Amongst the disinfectants which have been approved by WHO are 0.5% sodium or 0.5% sodium hydrogen peroxide. Alcohol wipes may be used for monitors. What needs to be ensured whenever a disinfectant is being used is the contact time. Ensure that all high-touch surfaces are taken care of. Now, fogging is something that all of us are curious and whether we should take up fogging during the pandemic times. WHO does not mention about fogging, and it's not really required to perform fogging. And when patients are there, it may be difficult to perform fogging on a routine basis. So I would discourage fogging on a routine basis, even while caring for COVID patients. No touch methods for disinfection are naturally preferred, but these could be very expensive equipments. They are usually based on UV light. And there should be, when it comes to surgical cases, there should be enough time between two surgeries to ensure environmental cleaning is thorough. Next is biomedical waste management. This should be as per local guidance. And in India, it is the Central Pollution Control Board that gives us guidance. So we have, over a period of time, had multiple revisions in the policy with respect to COVID-19 biomedical waste management. And the only change, we've reverted back to all our routine biomedical waste segregation when it comes to COVID-19. It's just that we need to ensure that it gets labeled as COVID-19 waste, and the transportation of COVID-19 waste is separate versus any other waste coming out of the hospital. So it is carried to the treatment center in separate vehicles. Now, another important aspect of preparing from the point of view of pandemic is understanding how diagnostics can be used for patient management. And I remember in the month of March and April, we had only the PCR at our disposal. But it's not the same any longer. We have a lot of other methods that are now available. Of course, the real-time PCR still remains the backbone, but there is also antigen testing that is available, which is as a point of care method. Then there are antibody testing methods also available, which at least the Indian Council of Medical Research has suggested that it be used only for epidemiological surveillance and not for diagnostics. And there is also CT chest available. And while most societies are not recommending the CT chest to be used frequently, we have found in at least in high burden settings like ours, where the number of asymptomatic infections can be anywhere between 30% to 80%, sometimes a CT chest certainly helps, particularly in patients where the PCR comes repeatedly negative. And so one needs to understand all of these tests better and accordingly time these investigations to be able to ensure and triage patients better. Now, again, world over, different testing protocols are now available, and this is one for surgical patients, where from the Stanford School of Medicine, where they say that based upon the type of surgery they have for endonasal, transsphenoidal, fess, and maxillary artery ligation, they have dual testing procedures, which is done within 72 hours of the surgery. So you could have a protocol for a single test, you could have a protocol for dual tests, and naturally for emergencies, we would not like and to wait for any testing strategy to be, testing results to be available. If you have at your disposal kind of tests or rapid PCRs like GeneXpert and BioFire naturally make use of them because they help a lot in triaging patients and better patient management. Now this comes from the British Dental Association, where they look at they are taking into consideration both PCR as well as antibody testing and trying to manage patients for surgery. Now here in India, at least the ICMR has instructed that antibody testing should only be used for epidemiological surveillance and not for diagnostic purposes. But naturally, there are other countries who may have their own protocols and policies where the antibody can be part of the diagnostic testing strategy. So let's look at another case. This is a 62-year-old male who was admitted in the non-COVID ICU post an exploratory laparotomy for a GI debulking surgery. He had a malignancy. Now his general condition was unstable and he was ventilated, and that's the reason why he was in a non-COVID ICU. So when he came, he was negative. Now on day 8 of admission, this patient develops new onset fever and has increased respiratory secretions. In the normal situation, naturally, one would have thought about ventilator-associated pneumonia and things like that, where bacterial infections would supersede. So in this situation of the pandemic, naturally, you would still think about a secondary bacterial infection or a device-associated infection here. But keep in mind that this could be nosocomial transmission of SARS-CoV-2, especially in high-burden settings, where a lot of people might actually be asymptomatic. So this patient would naturally need to get investigated for device-associated infections and, of course, send a PCR from the respiratory secretions to ensure that he's COVID negative. And in the time that you do this, this patient certainly needs to be transferred to a COVID ICU pending all of these. So one cannot take the chance of holding this patient over here because he will then be a risk for other patients as well as healthcare workers. Okay, another case here, a 65-year-old male was to be admitted for an elective total knee replacement procedure. Now his SARS-CoV-2 PCR was negative in the last 72 hours, and he didn't have any past history of COVID-19 disease, was never quarantined, had no family contacts and other things. So do we need any additional diagnostics, or just this one PCR negative, we would take this patient up for a surgery in the non-COVID area? Again, now this would depend upon your own policy, whether you want to do additional investigation. So again, maybe in a high burden country like ours, we would want to repeat a PCR. One, two, maybe you want to add an antibody investigation and check for the IgG. Of course, if the IgG is raised, then it would mean that he's already had the infection previously. And in fact, from our experience, we have found almost about 20% of asymptomatic infections within our population. So that's a significant number, and antibody could be an additional diagnostic used here, or else one may choose to do a CT scan. Please remember that early during the disease, the CT scan may have 15 to 20% false negatives. So keeping all of this in mind, this patient may, additional diagnostics may be recommended for this patient. Another important aspect of this kind of a procedure is going to be that all personnel who are involved in managing this patient in the OR should be appropriately wearing personal protective equipment. At least during the pandemic times, we should not compromise on personal protective equipment, whether the patient is positive or negative. So precautions need to be taken. Another case is, this is a 65-year-old female who needs admission for third chemotherapy cycle. Now she was found to be positive previously, and therefore her 4 weeks ago, and therefore her previous cycle had been deferred. So where should she get admitted now? This is a patient who is coming for chemotherapy. So she is already infected in the past 4 weeks. So do we need any additional investigations? Yes. We could probably do her antibodies, just do her IgG, and you would know if the IgG, she has raised a response. She it means that she is already done and passed the infection, and therefore could get admitted into the non-COVID area. Now, what if she has not mounted a response? That will remain a gray area that we will need further learning into. And till then, if she has not raised a response, this patient would have to be admitted into the suspect area for her chemotherapy cycle. So there are lots of permutations and combinations and lots of clinical scenarios that keep challenging us on a daily basis. And as the situation evolves, we need to keep ensuring that we read literature and prepare ourselves accordingly. Now, this is an excellent article which looks into the operational directives for surgery in managing COVID-19. And this is a very good chart that this paper gives us, which very clearly says that all personnel should be allocated. The route should be fixed, shortest possible, away from public, sanitize all the areas, so ensuring environmental disinfection. All materials should be dedicated. The patient should not be made to move about from here and there, and the OR should be dedicated. All devices should be dedicated, and ensure that people who use PPE should be in within that area of isolation, and people should not be moving around. So it this is for surgical care, and it helps us prepare for surgical preparedness during the COVID-19 pandemic. Another publication coming from Korea, published in the International Journal of Infectious Diseases, where they looked at safe hospital preparedness in their country. And again, the strategies are very similar. They classified them into hospital and government level strategies. So education and training, universal mask and hand hygiene, inpatient monitoring for new onset fever and respiratory symptoms, gate screening, specialized clinics. I mentioned about the fever clinics and the triage OPD that you could have for patients with symptoms of COVID-19. Preemptive isolation of pneumonia patients. So any patient with a respiratory complaint, isolate them. But in addition, in countries like India, which have a lot of asymptomatic infections, one needs to be careful about those who are coming for non-COVID related issues also. So one needs to be careful if it's screening them as well. High throughput diagnostics to be made available, and telemedicine, like your virtual OPD. So these were the strategies that South Korea adopted to ensure that they had a preparedness plan for hospital safety. So these are two situations where which are very similar to what we have discussed in all our slides on how we will ensure preparedness. And last but not the least, it's information, education and communication, a lot of posters. Training people also has become a little difficult during COVID times. There's not enough time because we are busy managing patients, but ensuring that posters are available as ready reckoners for our healthcare workers, ensuring that you have your communication line opened to them at for any kind of communication is something which is extremely crucial. So it's way to go for information, education and communication when it comes to managing the pandemic at this point in time. So finally, I would like to conclude by saying that the COVID-19 pandemic has actually brought in unprecedented challenges to the healthcare sector. There is a need to review and assess the local situation regularly and accordingly have a preparedness plan. Make changes in policies based upon new evidence that becomes available, and it meaning evidence changes very, very fast in the last 6 months. And workflow must be ensured such that it ensures patient as well as staff safety. Have clear SOPs, training, and mock drills to ensure such compliance. So practice IPC at all times. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, madam. That was a very wonderful presentation and very concise and precise, very, very informative. I think I was just noting down a few points, and you have answered all the questions that are there. So thank you so much for your presentation that was there. So as we said earlier, that there are a few questions that they were asked by people. So before we go to the questions, I think one of the things that I would like to add over here is that one has to also look at being prepared in other ways, that are such things like you need to have better engineering control system should be in place, so that things like, you know, needle stick injuries, things like heating ventilation issues are not happening. Those are taken care of. Other thing that we would also like to talk about is that one needs to also make system changes that are there in place, which basically look at what is things like telemedicine should be prompted. So we just had a session yesterday on telemedicine, and it's very important that teleconsultations and where people can stay at home and consult with doctors, so that there's a social distancing available that is there. That's what we want to do. So the other things that we also want to talk about is that PPEs that are there. One of the things that PPE standards also have to be maintained very importantly. So one of the things that you need to know is that if you're buying gowns and other things, they have to meet certain ISO standards like 16603 standards. If you're buying an N95 mask, it should meet ASTM standards of 2101. So these are some of the things that you need to ask. You need to ask whether the manufacturer who's providing you has good manufacturing GMP certificates. Second thing, you need to ask them whether they have ISO 13485 certificates for medical devices, quality management systems. So these are some things that you also need to ask, so that the kind of PPE that your one is wearing is also of a good quality and good standard that is there. So before we finish, we actually have a couple of questions that are there, ma'am. This is a question that has come from Reshma Dongal. It says that what if a patient has travel history but no symptoms? What will be the next step?
So I think, meaning again, we know that all patients with travel history are supposed to be high risk. And if they have traveled in the last 14 days to a high risk setting, it is better that we get the PCR done.
Okay, fine, ma'am. So that hopefully answers your question. The other thing, that next question that had this also, I also had a question on this, is that is UV light allowed for disinfection at the exhaust area instead of HEPA filters? Can we use UV lights at the exhaust areas
instead of HEPA filters? Yes.
Okay.
Yes, you can use it, but you know, the problem with UV light that I think we miss UV light. It would be an excellent disinfection strategy, okay. But remember that UV light would not work if there is dust.
Okay.
So it would require someone to inspect the area and ensuring to the maintenance plays a very important role.
Okay, right, ma'am. Thank you for that. The other thing that I would just like to add is that since you said that right now fogging is not recommended, I know, but if you look at some of the other studies that have come in the US and other things, they recommend something called as an electrostatic spraying, basically where an electrostatic current is generated and then the molecule becomes into small molecules and then sits on this thing that is there. So electrostatic spraying is recommended, especially after the patient has been left from the ward and you're doing a terminal cleaning. So this is something that is recommended. I know this is not yet present in India, but currently we have some new technologies which are present in India, which not only coat the room, but also give you a much long-term protection. So okay. Hopefully that will be a topic of discussion the next time. I don't want to take too much of time today, but next time we can talk about some of these new technologies which are there in the cleaning and disinfection space, especially which have emerged during this COVID-19 era. That's there. So let me look at if there are any other questions. This is again a question on fogging. So they're asking, how effective is fogging, as you said, as WHO, no fogging is an alternative.
So yes, I still think, meaning, of course, one can decide. A lot of healthcare facilities have adopted fogging. I think terminal disinfection is something very, very important. If that is done diligently, we wouldn't want to do fogging. Ensure that your air changes are correct. So your engineering part of it is something more important than, fogging. If you still want to take up fogging, you ensure that you don't have patients in the room and your HVAC is not common, which again I don't think is the practical situation that exists. I have never found my rooms to be vacant, so these are practical challenges that would prevent you from fogging.
Okay, sure, ma'am. Well put across over here. So again, there are no more questions that are there, I would just like to highlight upon the fact that my number and email address are displayed for anyone who wants to ask any more further questions. You can direct it to us and we will ask madam and we'll get back to you on email. We have your emails registered with us. So before we leave, we also would like you to join us on a new campaign, and we would like you to join us for this campaign, which has been brought to you by Shulk and IBAR. So there is an electronic checklist and online assessment form that is available, which Shulk has created so that it can help you prepare your hospital better for the COVID-19 pandemic. It's an online assessment tool. You can register. It's free of cost. And you can contact your local Shulk Care representative. If you do not know them, as we said, you can contact us through our phone number and email, and we will direct you who is the nearest person you can do this. You can contact you. You can download this form from them. You can click on the link, take the online assessment, and get to know how well your hospital is prepared, and get to know if there are any gaps, and if there are any gaps where you can complete them. So this is a new campaign. Please join us. So with that, I would like to say a very warm thank you to Madam for taking this wonderful session for all of us. On behalf of all the participants who are there from India and all other countries, we would like to thank you for participating today with us. And Madam, thank you so much for taking your time and being part of this session. Thank you so much. Thank you all participants.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Shashank. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks to Shulk team, and thanks to SATS Academy and Vijita as a team for having this done for us. Thank you so much.